Hallo, welkom hier zo bij Farmbook. Oké, okay, ons is nog steeds hier van Balfour Hyundai af, van die mooie dag. Ons gaan een beetje met Massey Ferguson praat oor hulle nieuwe Twin Rake, of seker nie so net nie, maar hulle Twin Rake en wat is die voordele van dit en wat is speciaal aan hierdie hark. So, ons praat met David Blackwood, uit al die paddase van Engeland afgekom, om ons te kom vertel van hierdie story, van die fabriek af. So, kom ons hoor, wat is die voordele van hierdie hark? David, how you doing?
Very well, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much. Okay, so you're here today, you're going to tell us a little bit about the Massey Twin Rake, the Rotor Rake. So give us a bit of background. First of all, what's your role at Massey and what do you do?
I work for Massey Ferguson's hay tool factory in Germany. Obviously, I'm not a German guy, but I work for the German factory. And my job is to develop the export business for the Massey Ferguson branded hay tools outside of the European markets.
So you're basically the specialist in all these tools?
Well, I like to think so.
Awesome. Okay, so give us a bit of background about the rake and the whole series that you've got.
Okay, no problem at all. Well, here in South Africa, we offer a full range of single rotor rotary rakes and also double rotor rotary rakes. The model we want to look about specifically today is the second model in the double rotary series, the 762 rake, and this is the example we have here today. Exactly like the disc mowers, these model names, they have a meaning that makes it easier for a simple person like myself. RK stands for the rake. 7.6 is the maximum working width. It can be reduced down to 6.8 meters, but maximum working width is 7.6 meters. 2 stands for two rotors, and then TR means it's got a transport chassis, and then C means it's center delivery, so the swath is created here in the middle. Rotary rakes offer a big advantage over the traditional wheel rake in that with the rotary rake you do not have to have the time actually engaging or touching the field surface, the ground. So with the rotary rake, you can set this height here, so there's some clearance, so you're still getting the grass, but the tine is not digging up the soil and contaminating your forage.
Yeah, and actually damaging the crop that's already on the ground.
Exactly, yes. So that's the big advantage of the rotary rake over the conventional wheel rake. If we then look at the actual double rotary rake like we have here today, this offers you a number of advantages over the single rotary rakes, and we're seeing here in South Africa more interest now in these double rotor rakes. There's a number of reasons for that. Firstly, you get very higher output, double output. Secondly, more and more people are using bigger round balers, so they want a bigger swath. But also very importantly, with the double rotor rake, it doesn't matter about the quality or the skills of the driver, the swath width in the middle will always be the constant width, irrespective of the manner in which the rake has been driven.
So you always get a constant...
You get a constant width of swath, yes.
So, and talking about the width of this, how do you adjust the width of the rake?
On these Massey Ferguson machines, it's a very simple system. And again, it's a patented system on these rakes, where we have this linkage system here, and you simply move this bar into one of these four positions. In this position here, the rake is out at its widest working width, that would be the 7.6 meters. Or if it's in here, it'll be the narrowest working width, so that will be the 6.8 meters working width.
6.8, and then basically what just happens is, if you make it narrower, that bar just pushes out and it basically brings in the wheels.
Yes.
Okay, exactly. Awesome.
Very, very simple system. Now, just on the rake itself, the first thing you will notice here is it's got a very low center of gravity. The main chassis beam here is flat and it's quite low, which makes this rake a very stable machine, especially if you're turning on very hilly, undulating grounds. With that design, that allows us to incorporate another patent on these machines, and that's the steer guard system.
Yeah.
And all double rotary rakes have steering on the rear wheels, but what's different on the Massey Ferguson rake is that steering linkage system is actually fitted inside the chassis of the rake.
It goes inside the chassis.
All the way up to the headstock at the front.
Let's have a look in the front exactly how this steering thing works. Because usually it's outside on most of these rakes, and there's a chance that you can actually damage it some way or form.
Yeah. Now, it's a very simple system. There is this lever with the ball up here. So as the tractor turns, the headstock turns, that moves the position of that ball, which then turns the steering. So it means that the wheels of the rake follow the same wheel tracking as
so
the
they're always in the wheel tracks of the tractor
when you're turning. Yes.
Awesome.
So again, that's the steer guard system, which is a unique patent on these Massey Ferguson rigs.
Okay, and then I just want to know, let's get to the real heart of the machine, you know, the stuff that usually always breaks.
So not on these machines.
Not on these machines. So just in terms of this basic gearbox or the head that you've got here, explain to me quickly what makes it special.
What's special about the rotor heads on all these Massey Ferguson rigs is that they're a modular construction. All of the rotor arm supports are individual units.
Yeah.
They're a greased system here. Inside the rotor head here, we have an input pinion. We have a ring gear. That's greased as well. We don't.
So it's not oil.
There's no oil in this rotor head, so there's no danger of that oil coming out and contaminating your crop. The advantage of this is if you do have a problem with one of these units, you simply take out the single unit and replace it. You don't have to replace the entire rotor head.
Yeah, that's usually a lot more. But then, are you going to charge me the same for that one as the other guys for the rotor head?
I would hope not. I would hope not. If we then move on to the way the tines are fixed on here, it's a very easy system to remove the tine. It just slides straight off like that.
And then that's easy.
You can hold it up here, and if you feel, get a chance when you're at Balfour tomorrow to feel just how heavy those tine arms are.
Oh, that's proper.
Proper steel.
And then you can see, daar kan julle sien, hierso so uit so lippie ding daarso. Wat 'n bietjie dikker is aan hierdie kant as aan die onderkant. So it's a lot thicker here than it's on this side. Why is that?
This here is what we call a predetermined a bending point.
Yeah.
So if the driver accidentally hits a tree or a fencing post on the outside, it will bend at this point rather than break off this higher cost component.
And I mean, that's a quick fix in a workshop. If you need to get on
exactly, you take it back to the workshop, you put it in the press, and you press it out straight. Very, very simple.
Cool. And then
the next thing I want to look at is on the tine arm itself, is how we actually fix the tines to the tine arm. You can see here the thick material of the tine arm, but also this metal here, which is extruded out.
How did you manage to get that? How do you do that?
That's a process that, again, we have developed ourselves using heat treatment and a spinning die.
Because usually you would have like another hole here, and the whole bolt goes through that, and that's how you fix it.
Yeah.
But why did you then go this route?
A number of reasons why we went this way. Firstly, if you start putting a bolt all the way through and make additional holes here, you immediately have a double weak spot on the tine arm. Also, if you have a bolt through it, then the end of the bolt will be here, and the grass and the forage will hang up on it.
Oh, that makes sense.
Thrown back out again. But as you can see, this is smooth, clean, leading edge. So that's just some little features just on the area of the tine arms themselves.
And the steel of the basic tines and so, is it just the usual
it's
stuff?
It's what we call Super C quality spring steel.
Okay, and that means?
it's basically a high spring tension steel. So it is, and all these tines we will do samples in the factory where we run them through 200,000 deflections to make sure that they don't break.
So they don't break and there's no issues on that.
Exactly.
Okay, and then if I want to transport, what do I do with the tines?
Well, if it's a very simple system, again, you just simply take them off here and they carry it through here. And we've got a nice little storage place in here. And it locks in with the same pin.
Quick and easy.
Exactly.
No hassles and problems like that. So, in terms of, let's get this back quickly.
Yeah. So what we talked before about the big advantage of the rotary rake was that the tines do not have to contact the field. So to allow the rig to do that, the rotor head must freely float in three dimensions.
Yes.
It must float from side to side, but also it must float from front to back. And on the Massey Ferguson rig here, we have this little track here, which we've got a patent on this design here, and that allows that rotor head.
You guys
head.
Are full of patents, eh?
We have a lot of engineering expertise in the factory, more than 100 years experience.
Jeez.
So that allows the rotor head to float front to back,
yep,
as it follows the ground.
Oh, that's good. So when you lift it up, when you get out of a field, which part will then lift up first?
Another advantage of that system is that when you do lift it, the front tine, we call it jet effect.
Yeah.
So it's the same way as when an airplane is taking off.
Ah, okay.
So when you lift it,
must be a marketer that thought of that.
Yeah, has to be, yeah. So the front tines will lift up first, and then it goes up.
Yeah.
And then when you put it back into work, it goes down in the back, goes down first, and then it goes forward to the front. And that stops the front tines from digging into the paddock and contaminating your forage.
Having a problem there. And in terms of infields working, how many years has this been on the market? Have it been working in Europe?
Oh, this concept of these rotary rakes and this rotor head concept here, we've been building up for more than 15 years.
Yeah.
So it's well proven all around the world. And these rotary rakes are probably some of our best selling products in most markets in the world.
And so they are tried and tested,
yes.
Yeah, because that's the most important part of this. And in terms of when I'm looking for spares, I know that they will be available.
Yep.
So just quickly again then, in terms of what do you think is the biggest advantage? Because there is two distinct differences between wheel rakes and having these twin rotor rakes, is that one, the wheel rake is a lot cheaper to buy, first off, and
there is that, yes.
And we would think that maybe it's cheaper to maintain, but that could be a preconceived perception that that farmers has, just because it's a lot cheaper from the get-go. Mm-hmm. But in terms of the advantages that this has got over and above a wheel rake, what would you say is the biggest
point? Well, I'd say the biggest advantage is there's less crop contamination. And farmers around the world are becoming more professional, and they milk producers, beef producers, they're becoming more professional. They're demanding higher quality forage. They're demanding less contamination in that forage. And the only way you can reduce that contamination is use the rotary rake, where the tines do not actually engage with the soil and rake the soil into the swath. The second advantage is that the swath that is produced by this rake is a more consistent swath. It's a better profile, and that means that with the baler, you get a much better form baler, a more even shape on your bale. The guy that's driving the baler, it's easy for him to follow the swath. He doesn't have to go from side to side because he's got a nice constant swath.
Yeah, and I mean, especially when you're looking at these big back balers, where that really becomes important to get the weight into the bale.
Yeah.
I know, definitely. David, thank you very much.
No problem. Thank you.